ashes, the spirits light up the night, looking down the edge of forever. So stop me and take my advice.
Hey.
You beat me.
I did.
So everybody, welcome to Untold Radio, and please refrain from teasing Alex because he's got COVID. So you won't do good, are you?
No, a lot better.
You sound like you have that grunge.
Yeah.
How long did your fever last?
The last time I had a fever was last night.
Okay, so pretty.
Yeah, it's weird. It like goes away. It goes away, and then
stay home. Just stay home for another few days. Don't come in. You're thinking of coming in tomorrow? No, don't. Friday maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't want
probably the same to spread.
No. The grunge. So anyhow, tonight we've got a really probably a guest we should have had on a long, long, long time ago, and that's Joe Frascella, because Joe has had a whole bunch of experiences with me, including up at Snelgrove.
Yes.
So, you know, he's been up there. He was even up there for the last cabin attack. He's the one that sat and looked out the window with Blaine one night, the entire night. They never went to bed. They just sat there like two monkeys perched on a bunk bed. They were just looking out the window. Yep.
Yeah, and he was on that episode of MonsterQuest. You all were.
Yeah, he's in there. Maybe we can play a clip from that later when we get into the show, maybe. Maybe we can get away with it.
Yeah, if we can.
I sent it to you in Messenger.
Oh, you did? Oh, okay.
Part one cool. And part two. So you can be thinking about that. So anyhow, but yeah, what we were talking, referring about the Snelgrove Lake cabin that was attacked. So it's the Snelgrove Lake attack, which is, you know, partially famous if you're in the know. And if you're not, that's probably you're not in the audience anyhow, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. So anyhow, but Joe's a great friend, and you know, we've got a lot of cool stories we'll tell, including stories you'll never hear again, because I'm never going to repeat them, and you're never going to hear them anywhere else. So
perfect.
Stick around, bottom of the hour. Okay, so blah blah blah. So I was going to start talking about something else that's a little bit, excuse me, weird. God, I hope I'm not coming down with your grunge. and that's something new that's being developed in a very, very quick way, which is smarter than AI. So, and this is called, and just hang on, I got my notes. I got brain fog today too. Okay. So it is called an organoid. Have you ever heard of an organoid before?
No. Is it like a organ robot thing?
No. So what they're doing is they're taking just a few brain cells, right? Combining them with plastics in a lattice. And then they're letting them teach themselves. So it's basically little mini brains they're developing.
Little mini
so brains. Got one now. It just three cells. It learned how to play Pong. So I want you to think about this. Three brain cells. Right now, to this day, it's playing Pong 24 hours a day.
So it's probably pretty good at it.
And it's good at it, yeah. Of course, you couldn't beat it. Three cells. So now I want you to picture an entire room full of these cells.
Playing Pong?
No, not playing Pong. Not playing Pong.
What are they doing?
They're doing evil. I don't know.
Doing
that's why
evil.
It's scary. They're working on the next nuclear, God knows what.
Some who knows? Frankenstein thing.
Well, AI is scary.
Yeah.
I mean, did you hear some of the stories that are coming out on AI already on GPT-4.
Yes.
Already. This thing has already figured out a way towards lying.
Yeah.
Did you hear about this?
Yeah.
It's lying. So it's figured out a way to evade detection and certain things in its line to humans now. Nice. Okay, so organoids. So that's why I just thought it was scary, you know, and kind of unlock that new fear. If anybody's got a fear of AI, some people do. I do because I get it. I mean, I play with it, and it's scary how quick it can create things.
Yeah, it's insane. Yep.
So these organoids are basically, so it says human cells or brain cells, you can make them out of just human cells too, that populate scaffolding, for instance. They're basically now a mini brain. So they've taken a few brain cells into just literally in a petri dish. And it's now taught itself to play Pong. So like I said, imagine a whole room full. So the human brain is 2,000 terabytes.
So what are they going to do, program humans eventually?
What do you mean program humans?
You know?
What?
So you start with Pong and then eventually you program. Well,
they're just
going to
be used in computers. They're going to make computers out of organs.
They're going to print people.
No, it's not at all what I said. They're going to take human cells and turn them into a thinking computer that can then outdo AI.
That's smarter.
Because it's got that human element to it.
The human element.
Because the human brain is 2,000 terabytes. And, you know, that would take up a whole room, you know, just to have, you know, how many terabytes. 2,000 terabytes would take up a whole room. That's one human. But now picture a whole room full of organoids where each one is 2,000 terabytes.
So that's a lot of terabytes.
Yeah. And think about the computing power. So now we've got a problem.
So is that like a master brain?
Well, yeah, it's a master brain. It's a strolling brain. It's a brain that can stroll.
Yeah, it's a strolling brain.
Oh my God. We're dealing with a slightly slower Alex.
This is the cough syrup talking.
I hear what are those pills I'm hearing?
Oh, it's my cough drops.
Oh, cough drops. Oh, okay. All right, what do we got next? Enough of that crap. So I have a question for you. Because I had a banana right before I came on the air.
Was it good?
I was hungry. And I'm like, well, it's not enough time to have dinner. So I grabbed a very healthy banana. We all know bananas are healthy.
Very healthy.
But let me ask you a question. Who eats more bananas, right? So, okay, you're ready? Just hang on now. You got to answer this now. Let's see here. Da-da-da-da-da. God, I'm slow too. What the heck's wrong with me? So who eats more banana? Okay, we eat more bananas than monkeys. As monkeys do not taste good. So I wanted to make that statement.
We eat more bananas than monkeys.
We don't eat monkeys. We eat bananas.
We do.
Yeah. So monkeys don't taste good.
We don't actually physically eat them.
So the question is, who eats more bananas than monkeys?
Humans.
Yeah, we eat more bananas. monkeys do not taste good. That's the tagline. Okay, never mind.
Can you even eat monkeys? Like,
oh my God, you're just thinking way too deep. Yeah, they do in Thailand and
but like if you're a tourist, can you?
Yeah, you can go to Thailand to eat monkeys. Nice. Why are you thinking about that? You have COVID. Don't think about that crap. Okay, but anyhow, I'll do. Because, you know, I've done weird facts on potatoes and, you know, strawberries and onions. And so we're back to plant-based weird facts.
Plant-based weird facts.
Yeah. So we're back to bananas. So did you know that when bananas are ripe, they'll glow under a black light or a UV light? They glow blue.
No, I thought that meant there was something
wrong. I had a blue banana before. It was so ripe, it was almost alcoholic.
Really?
I almost felt like I was going to get drunk.
Off a banana.
Yes. Anyhow, blah, blah, blah. Did we give away some books last week?
Yeah.
By the way, there was a guy, and I can't remember his name. He's in. He actually won the damn trivia question, and that because he put none, and I didn't catch the word none, and then Uncle Bones put zero, and he won. So we got to help the other guy too. I think his name's Derek. So Derek, if you're listening, we owe you a book too.
Yeah. Here, let me.
No, don't. No, not now.
Not now.
It was last week.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just look it up last week. I already wrote him a note.
Okay. So does he know how to reach out to me?
Yes, he does.
Okay.
So anyhow, maybe he'll be in chat tonight. Okay. Bananas are one of the very few foods that have dopamine in it. It goes right to your brain, makes you happy.
Really?
Yeah. So if you're feeling down, have a banana.
Or two.
Bananas truly are slippery. They're almost as slippery as ice. If you measure the coefficient, the actual coefficient.
So you can learn from cartoons.
Oh, God. Apparently. Bananas also contain L-DOPA, a brain neurotransmitter.
Oh, L-DOPA. Okay, so yeah, that does boost your mood.
Yeah, L-DOPA. God, I swear I'm having a hot flash talking to you. I gotta put my pan on. Oh my God. Anyhow. Okay. Iceland has the biggest banana plantation. Iceland in Europe. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Of course not. How would you? Why would you? You wouldn't. These are things you only learn on Untold Radio.
Yes. Yes, because they're untold.
And I've been to Iceland 3 times, and I've never seen any plantation banana. Apparently, it's indoors. Bananas are what percentage of water, Alex, do you think? Take a guess.
80%.
You're close. 78%. Mm. Bananas contain potassium.
Yes.
Which is important. It's an important mineral. But did you know bananas are one of the only foods that's actually radioactive?
No.
Yeah, they are. They're actually, if you eat 25 bananas, you could have a dangerous amount of radioactivity because the potassium in the bananas is radioactive.
Oh.
So don't eat 25 bananas because then you could actually get a dangerous dose of radiation.
Probably don't want to sleep by them too.
Yeah, don't sleep by a bunch of bananas. Oh my God. Okay. This one, you're definitely not. You're going to freak out on. And some of us probably share more DNA with bananas than others, but most humans share 50% of their DNA with a banana. Swear to God.
50%?
Yep, 50% of the DNA. I know I do. 50% of my DNA is banana DNA.
Really?
Yeah, 60% of your DNA is banana DNA.
60%?
For you, yes.
Just for you.
Okay. Bananas are a berry. They're considered a berry, but a strawberry is not a berry.
What is a strawberry? A legume?
I don't know. It's not a legume. A legume is a bean. It's not a bean.
What is it?
I don't know.
How do you know it's not a...
But you're trying to put me on the spot like I do you, huh? You're trying to flip this thing around, aren't you? Okay. All right. So for a free Owl Moon Lab book, Do Bananas Float? First person to say in the chat,
no Do Bananas Googling. Float?
Yes or no? It's a yes or no question. Alex, go ahead. Take a guess. Don't
they
cheat.
They float?
Okay.
Yep.
So who said yes? Yeah, see, I got to look more careful now.
Oh, Jesus. A lot of yeses. It's
like, all right, stop. Slow down, everybody. It looks like
Marion was the first Marion. Yes.
So you won a Owl Moon Lab book. Everybody did good. Most people guessed yes, they do float.
No, they just copied me.
Eyes in the woods, you need to go back to bed. Uncle Bowens, he said no too. So, anyhow. Okay. Monkeys peel bananas right side up, which is from the bottom up, what we think is the bottom. That's actually the top of the banana for peeling. So monkeys do it right. So a banana plant is considered a giant herb. The whole thing's an herb.
It's an herb?
It's an herb. Yeah, the plant. And we did mention bananas are actually radioactive. You'd have to eat 27 bananas a day to pose any radiation risk. So you'd have to sleep with 27 bananas each night or eat them. Okay. Wild bananas have a ton of seeds. So if you ever get a banana that's like just really full of seeds, it might be a wild banana. Bananas grow in 150 countries.
150.
Yeah. That I know that fact just got you all excited. You'll be able to sleep tonight. So how many bananas are eaten every year, Mr. Alex?
3 trillion.
3 trillion. You're way off as usual. It's over 100 billion, but not three. How many did you?
Three trillion.
3 trillion. Now you're way off. Only 100 billion. That's still a lot.
Well, you know,
but that's per year.
Rot.
That's 30. Yeah. It's...
What percentage of the bananas you buy do you eat?
And oh my god, it's probably like 20. Yeah, they always rot on you.
Right.
Yeah, they do. So anyhow, we just got the biggest, the greenest bananas I've ever seen from some grocery service. Took like a week for them to ripen, but they went from really green to really ripe, just like that.
Yeah, you think they're going to last longer.
Bananas will help protect your skin from sun damage.
If you eat them?
Especially for you, Alex. That's a good thing for you, bananas.
Yeah.
In fact, I think you have been eating bananas.
Yeah.
You have no sun damage. None. Canada grows over 100 types of bananas in Canada.
In Canada?
Yeah.
They can even grow them?
Well, they grow them indoors in greenhouses. What are you thinking? They don't grow them outside.
They're not growing them next to the pine trees? Well,
maybe in the summer. Maybe they might in the summer. Twinkies were originally banana flavored.
Twinkies were banana flavored? Is that why they're yellow?
Do you remember a Twinkie? You ever had a Twinkie?
Yeah, I have.
I haven't had a Twinkie in, oh my God, so many years. It's a great 30 years, snack. 40 years. Okay, you remember those snowballs, those coconut Hostess snowballs?
Oh, yeah.
I went shopping with my producer from Wild About Animals. Mm-hmm. One time he goes, he calls me up, what are you doing? I go, I got to go grocery shopping. He goes, can I come with? I'm like, okay. So he comes with, and we go shopping, and he buys like 20 packs of those pink coconut snowballs.
Oh, nice.
I'm like, what in the world? First off, what person calls another couple and then joins them grocery shopping?
And then fills the cart with snowballs?
And then fills his cart with pink coconut snowballs. Okay. Banana peels are very edible, and they're best when they're ripe. And you can bake them, and you can blend them, whatever that means. Put them in the blender.
You can blend them.
Yep. Bananas might go extinct because of Panama disease, the type of fungus. Mm. There's apparently some fungus loose in bananas. Are you worried? No.
I'm terrified.
Okay. We're almost done with bananas. There's a banana called the Big Mike banana. And they were the most popular variety of bananas until the 1960s. Big Mike banana. I'm just reading this crap.
Have you ever had a Big Mike?
I don't know. No. Never.
You don't know if you've ever had one?
Have you? Oh my God, you need to go back to bed.
Is it worse if you do or you don't?
You can stop now. Oh my God. So they think bananas were one of the first cultivated foods up to 8,000 BC. So that's 10,000 years ago, dude.
10,000.
They were growing years. Big Mike bananas 10,000 years ago. Yep.
Is that what they were called 10,000 years ago too?
Big mics. Yeah, big mics. Yeah. The scientific name for the Big Mike banana is, and this is why they call them Big Mikes. Hang on here. I got to get scientific now. To just wipe that smile off your face. Blah, blah, blah. It's called a gross Mitchell banana.
Mm, gross.
So that's where the Big Mike came in.
That's where it came.
Yeah.
In.
Yeah. So the scientific name has got kind of that Michael in it.
Yeah.
And gross, I think, means large in Latin. So Big Mike.
Big Mike.
Banana plants are the largest herb on the planet. And the banana plant is technically an herb. The one that we eat most in the United States is... doesn't even say. What the heck? Oh, it's called the SW green banana. They have a high amount of resistant starch that makes them a prebiotic. And green bananas have less overall absorbable carbohydrates than a ripe banana. So you can lose more weight if you eat a green banana.
You can lose more weight if you eat a green banana? Because they taste awful.
I know they do.
You're not going to eat
green bananas have a low glycemic load. So
it's got a low load.
Don't eat bananas if you have an allergy or to latex. I mean, you could have a banana allergy if you're sensitive to latex.
So you don't want to take a Big Mike if you're allergic
to latex. Right. And this is, I'm not giving medical advice here on anything. Read your own. So that's enough about bananas. Let's get away from that damn topic. Okay.
Is it time for
No.
No, it's not.
No, it's almost time. I was gonna send you a picture. Maybe I did. Did I send you that Patty picture of the calf from the Patterson Gimlin footage?
Yeah, you did. Do you want me to pull
that up? I want you to whip that up there because I was gonna talk about it. I don't know anything about, you know, this could be completely fake. But if it's real, it's super interesting.
Here we go. All right, let me drag it in here. So how did you find this?
It was on Facebook, believe it or not, from a man who I'm going to remain unnamed, who claims he is enhancing the footage or, you know, turning it into stills. We'll see. I have no opinion because I haven't studied what he's doing. And I believe the guy sent me a friend request. Okay. Do you see the bumps?
Yeah.
Under the, on the skin?
Yeah.
Those would be, what do you call them? Like ingrown hairs.
Yeah.
Pus filled. What do they call those?
Zits?
Well, basically. But we don't
acne,
some type of an acne. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can't think of the name, but it's interesting if that's real.
Yeah. It definitely gives it more credibility.
And by the way, people are teasing you, Alex, even though you're sick, they're still teasing you.
Of course.
Yeah. John Ayers is teasing you right now.
If they miss, what are they saying?
Just stuff.
Alex, you lose weight because they taste terrible.
And you won't eat them. That's kind of a tease, isn't it? Assist. Lori had the right name, Assist.
Assist, yeah.
And then Deborah said a lipoma, yeah. So it's interesting. So we'll just, take that off and enough of that.
Here's a zoom
close
in.
Up, yep. It's interesting, skin details. It's just something funny because you see all the hair. Yeah, that looks like it's been photoshopped to me on the right side, on the far right side.
So that's the problem, right? You could have someone go in and
photoshop this. You could go photograph your dog's butt and then superimpose it on there, and I could do it too. The thing is, if you want to fake stuff, man, it's so easy nowadays.
I know. It makes it hard.
It's just shame on anybody who does. That's all I can say. I don't think it's possible that kind of detail out of the Patterson, but I thought I'd show it. Did you ever hear of the Roswell, this has actually come up with the government now. The Roswell before Roswell, you know, Roswell happened in 47, the supposed crash. But apparently the actual Senate intelligence is investigating one that happened January 1st, 1945, that also had occupants in it, apparently, and witnesses. And it's been a cover-up, a really good cover-up. Apparently, it's been a successful cover-up. But in the spending bill, they've actually requested all of the documents concerning this particular crash from the military. So there you go. Apparently, this craft was avocado-shaped, was carted away by the U.S. government, and apparently this is going to, it's this week when they're required provide the docs, or at least agreed to. So it's in the, it's actually, they've tied it to the defense spending bill. So turn over this info or don't. What are you doing?
Sorry, I'm getting attacked.
You're getting attacked.
Abe won the banana question. If you just email me Abe, I'll get you the book.
What happened? What about who?
I sent Marion one. What she did, it was Abe.
That was Abe Del Rio?
Is he?
Oh, it was somebody else?
Yeah.
Well, we got to give the one I said we were going to give a book to also.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't do that.
All right, let's do that.
So there was somebody before her?
Yeah, I missed it.
I missed it too. How in the world?
Yeah, so that's great. Yeah, why don't you both email me?
Yes. How about that? Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, we'll give you both a book. That's how nice Alex is. All right, let's just get rid of, let's do our clips, and then we'll bring Joey, our guest, on.
Okay, awesome. You ready?
So I am ready.
All right, let's do it.
There, you're all alone. I'm here.
What's going on?
My camera off. Hey, come back. Did you do yours too? Why? Man, you're in a mood. Okay. So, what in the world? This is interesting. If anybody can identify what this is, dangling below this helicopter, I would like to know. I've been told it is a groundwater survey they're doing using LiDAR. Go ahead and play it. Can you get the... No, there we go. What in the world? It looks like kind of an octagon-shaped thing. And, you know, of course, the person who filmed it had no idea what it was, which is why they posted it. Does anybody know what that is? They said it's a water. One guy said it was a water survey, which makes the most sense to me with LiDAR. All right, clip two. This is probably one of the most beautiful things you'll ever see. It's something that actually we experience here in Minnesota when all of our apple trees and our ornamental apple trees bloom. So in May, we'll have flowers and trees like this everywhere. This is in Japan. There are cherry blossoms. 700,000 trees bloomed. Pretty cool, huh? Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah. That's incredible.
Yep. Imagine the smell. Definitely smell better than your socks.
I would hope so.
Okay. Enough of that. Clip three. Now, I'm not sure you can play the sound on this because it's got that Dumb Ways to Die song.
Yeah.
Think we can get away with that?
No, we'll get nailed.
You think we'll get nailed?
Oh, yeah.
How about just for the last second? We just turn it on just right after the kangaroo comes through the fence. You got to hear the growl. This thing makes quite a noise. She's trying to rescue a baby. Joey, that's trapped in the fence. You hear that?
Oh, yeah.
And right before, of course, that's the song Dumb Ways to Die plays. Okay. Clip four. This is something I would not do. He's just, you got to see this. I would not do this. I have no tolerance for lions. None. Zero. Just have your leg dangling out there with a wild lion.
Oh, my God.
Just think of what could go wrong here. The damn thing's licking his chops, too. It's funny he doesn't say, here, you know, start twitching. He did the right thing. He's holding still. But that's just, you know, you can't trust in lion.
No.
Gosh. So then clip 4A is why you can't trust a lion.
Oh, no.
No, what? You didn't download?
Oh, no, I just...
That's fine. It's no big deal.
No, I got it.
Oh, there you go. You gotta play the sound on this. Hey. Full blast. Hey. Hey. The guy's just defending himself. Saying, hey.
How big do those?
I mean, he's there in an open, one of those open safari carts. No way would I ever do that. I'm not that stupid.
No, they just jump right in.
Oh, yeah, they have. They have plenty of times. And the guy, yeah, he's got a stick.
He's got a stick.
A stick. But nice. The power these things have and the speed of them is insane. I mean, I've had two friends now eaten by one was eaten by a lion. Another friend was eaten by a tiger. Two of them I've lost.
On like safaris?
No, in Minnesota here, thinking they could handle them.
As like a pet?
Yeah, like a pet, yeah.
Can you legally have them here as pets?
Sure. Really? Yeah, you can. Yeah. Yeah, there's people that they'll collect 20, 30 of them.
30?
I don't know. Yeah, of course. It's completely legal here. And a lot of states it's legal in.
What's the death rate of someone having a pet fly?
I don't know what the stats are, but every year people get killed by their own tiger.
Yeah,
it's sad, you know. They actually were pretty cool people. Anyhow, what do we got next? Clip five. So this is interesting. Maybe this is how Bigfoots are avoiding leaving footprints. There you go. That's how they're doing it.
Yeah, you turn around and they're right above you.
Can you imagine if he was using his hands?
Don't look up.
He's not even using his hands to go up or down.
Imagine.
So what if Bigfoot's no parkour?
They might.
Yeah. So what do you call that? Leg core?
Leg core?
What do you call that? What that guy was doing?
Well, if it's a Bigfoot, it'd be Sasquatch.
You're in a trance. I can see it. We're losing Alex quickly.
Tonight is sponsored by NyQuil.
Yes. Okay. Clip six, robots are not perfect.
Robots are not perfect.
They're not perfect. Not even close to perfect, as you will see.
New Terminator. Oh, one more time. Wow.
Nice.
She's being pursued.
Yeah. Doesn't work. Enough of that. Okay. You ever heard the term, the guy flipped his wig?
No. Is that like a new...
You've never term? Heard that term? That used to be how you would describe someone who got mad or angry. You know, the guy flipped his wig.
Flipped his wig.
Or he went crazy. Anyhow. Play clip seven. There's two guys that are flipping their wings, saying hello. That's not the funniest thing you've ever seen.
They're laughing about it.
Yeah, obviously it's fake, but it's not, you know, stage. I guess that would be a stage video. No? All right. Okay, this next clip, the sound is clean. It's a goofy clip. We'll just call it Ding Dong, and it's kind of an oh my god little clip. You always play the ending.
Ding Dong.
I just love the ending. It's just ding. You got to play it one more
time. All right, all right.
It was a personal favorite.
Ding Dong.
Anyhow.
How tall is she?
It's like the Amber Glow. What?
How tall is that woman?
I don't know. She had elevator shoes on.
Oh, yeah. She's
okay, cheating. Clip 9. This is interesting. It's obviously a strange cloud. Be a lot of opinions on this. These are being filmed all over, you know, clouds like this that are kind of just act weird. And this is one of them. You got to play the whole clip. You can play the audio. It's safe.
It's moving, man. It's like fucking... It's rotating.
Well, I guess it's not safe. No, it's fine. Just play it.
Bro, what if...
So? What's the deal with the cloud, do you think?
It's
And I know that people have filmed these black smoke rings, and I know there's a way to duplicate
it's
that,
moving,
you know, artificially.
Like fucking...
But this thing didn't start. If you actually look at the edge, you see that ball of cloud that's rotating around the ring. That can't be duplicated.
Is there something in that cloud?
That could be. Yeah, it could be.
Yeah.
UFOs do punch holes in clouds and do weird things. All right, enough of that crap. Okay, we're almost done. Clip 10. We all see these guy wire towers held up by guy wires for radio towers, right?
Yeah.
Cell towers. But you have to know if one of those guy wires comes loose, the whole thing's going to do this. They do come down. You got to play the audio. You got to start it over and play it. Put it up loud. You hear that guy wire swinging around?
Yeah.
So these towers are very weak on their own. They really, I did a forensic car accident reconstruction for General Motors once. And we had to get a tower way up in the, you know, at the actual site of the accident. And we had to get a camera way up high. And this is before, you know, drones. And even a drone wouldn't work. It had to be stable. Because the idea was we're going to film this. We recreated the car accident and film it from 9 different angles. Well, one of them had to be an up angle. So we just used steel poles or aluminum poles. But we would put a section in and use bungee guy wires and just keep raising it. Then we'd get that one stable and put another pole, lengthen the bungee cords, put it up higher, put another section, and we just kept going up. Man, we were up like 200, 300 feet. That's a lot of years ago. But we were, that thing got featured in Forensic Magazine because they were so impressed with all this stuff we did out in the field. So anyhow, but that's, the guy wires are interesting. Basically, there's no limit as long as you have equal pressure on all sides. You could go to the moon, in theory, if you had enough guy wires.
But as long as it's stable.
As long as you have guy wires.
Yeah.
Yeah, that have equal tension. Yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise you are.
We're losing Alex quick.
Oh, otherwise, you stop doing this.
Yeah. Okay. Anyhow. So, I had bonus footage, which is, yeah, go ahead and play it. It's pretty interesting.
Audio good?
Yeah, I think. Something underwater, and you'll never guess what it is. But it's some kind of a thing that can be underwater that people just don't normally think it would be. And this could account for even, like, champ sightings at times.
Loch Ness?
Or yeah, even Loch Ness, maybe. I don't really know what kind of mammals they have. It was a moose. But they'll swim underwater, they'll eat plants, and they'll stay under for quite a while. That's a big animal to be under there.
Yeah.
Okay. Double bonus footage is the best camo on a bird. We have had these birds on. We've shown them before. But just go ahead and play double bonus footage. Then we're done for sure. You don't see it? That's fine.
Oh.
You have that look. There you go. The most camouflaged bird in the world for sure. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
There's two birds there. It's a relative to the nature. I call them ghost birds. It's basically a nighthawk. Okay, enough of that. Are we ready to talk about Bigfoot? Snelgrove?
Yes. Yes. He's in the back room, Uncle Joey.
Yep, and you need a ice water to the face.
Yeah, probably.
Okay, so God, I don't even know how to introduce Joe. So I've known Joe for going on 40 years, long time. He is an operations manager. You work with Joe?
Yeah.
Joe is, you know, I don't know. What do we call? What's the nickname? Jolton Joe, we call him. But he's best friend. What's better than even a best friend is an old friend, because you have so much perspective on your friendship.
Yeah.
And Joe had been going to Snelgrove. Actually, Joe was with me the first time I went to Snelgrove, believe it or not. That's interesting. I just remembered that just now.
First time.
And the whole trip was basically a scary trip, because we got in a little plane crash on the way up, not in the float plane, but on the little plane, because, well, we'll talk about that. Let's get him on. We'll tell that story.
Hello, there guys.
There he is. Hey, Joey.
Hey, Joey. There's Alex and Doug. Good to see you.
Yeah, it's good to
long
see
time
you.
No see.
Do you remember? Okay, so you were with the first time we went to Snelgrove, correct?
Oh, yep, 100%.
And that was the Buddy Holly trip.
Yes.
Remember, we were driving. We were in my car, your car.
Yep.
We were going to the Anoka County Airport. And I said, this is a true story. This is
quote unquote, yep.
I said, I hope to God, because we saw the sky turning black, I hope to God that song, That'll Be the Day I Die, does not come on. And within 3 seconds, that song came on.
It literally came on. We weren't even at the airport yet. We were pulling in.
Yep.
And that came on. We were like, oh, my goodness.
I don't know if you've heard that song, Alex.
Yeah, That'll Be the Day That I Die.
Yeah, yep, yeah. Yep.
I don't want to ruin it.
And it was weird because double weird because, one, I had met the band up at the Anoka County Fairgrounds. Remember when we actually hired the Buddy Holly band to play at that concert? And so I got to hang out with the band and, you know, not Buddy Holly, he was gone, but all the rest of the other two, Junior and the other guy. Anyhow, but it was just so weird that all of a sudden that song came on. Then we get in the plane, and what was the guy doing, our pilot? He was trying to, gaff taped wires together?
Yeah, the pilot was talking to the other guy that was traveling with us, and he said, hey, where's the gaff? He was looking for some tape to put the wires up underneath the dashboard, and I looked at Doug, and he looked at me, and we didn't say anything, but God, it was a moment.
Yeah.
It was two moments before we even got off the ground.
Yeah, the sky was turning blacker and black, and this was... It's, I remember this was your first small plane ride.
It was my very first plane ride in a small plane. And and I remember when we got up.
But there was a prank I played on you also.
Yep. That was later.
No, but it was on the plane. I played the prank on you.
Oh, yeah. See, I have faded memories of that.
Okay. Do you remember
we've had
the
so
vest.
Many pranks over the years.
Okay. I told you to wear your vest, your water vest, because we'd end up doing a water landing.
And I did. Yep.
Which is a good thing to do. But my prank, my plan was to get you to pull that blow up lever before we landed. That was my goal.
Yep. And it worked.
So we, as I remember, we're flying up north. We're flying into the storm, which isn't good. It was actually dangerous. The ceiling was coming down. This guy was flying visual flight rules only, so he could not use his gauges. So we had to stay below the clouds, and they were getting lower. You remember this?
Every moment of it.
Lower and lower and lower. And all of a sudden, you know, we're looking to land somewhere, because we know we're going to hit the trees at any moment. I mean, we're like, the wheels are damn near touching the trees. And I said, Joe, remember what I told you about your life vest? We may have to make a water landing. And we may have really had to have, because I didn't know. I mean, I actually had my vest on too at that point. So then we, all of a sudden, the pilot sees the runway out of the corner of his eye, or a place to land. And he did what they call it, kind of a Gila drop. They do a stall, you know, where you just drop the plane down. You know what I'm talking about, Joe?
Oh, yes. I was there.
Okay. I said, pull your whatever. And you did. And you pulled it and it, poof, it blew up. And then Lars dropped the plane right out of the sky into that parking lot or wherever it was.
Yeah. He found that dirt runway that was really, it was really hard for him to see. And it was just off to the left that I remember. And I remember all sorts of alarms and whistles and stuff going off. And so
stall warning lights.
Yeah, it was stall warning lights, but I didn't know that. And you knew it. I didn't know it. But it was a moment, another moment.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
So that trip just kept giving. Well, then you remember the gentleman we were with was getting sicker and sicker.
Yep.
And I started filming. Anyhow, make a long story. Why don't you tell this story? So we get to we end up taking the float plane to the lake.
Yep.
With the outfitter, and then you tell the story from there.
Well, as much as I
remember.
This is at Snell. We're actually on Snell. And it's a remote cabin. It's the only cabin on the lake, and we're probably, 140 miles north of the border, minimum. I think the nearest town is that we looked was like 90 miles away from there that had any population. Anyways, so we're at Snell, and so we all unpack our stuff and we decide to go fishing right away. So Doug and I take one boat, and the two other guys we were fishing with hopped in the other boat. And
we had the pilot with us.
We had the pilot with us. That's right. And then I remember, one of the other guys that we were with came back to our boat. I don't know how he found us, but said that the other fisherman that we were with was getting really sick. And so
they need to leave now.
And so the pilot left. And so we all went back to the cabin, and Doug and I looked at each other and said, well, what do we do now? Well, let's go fish, because it was just the two of us in this huge, huge mass of land and water. And again, this is my first trip up to any place like that. And it was very, very surreal. Yeah. I'll never forget that moment.
Well, we didn't even know how to get back to the cabin.
Well, no. I mean, that's just it. I mean, I don't even know how the pilot found us to begin with. And then we had to find our way back to the cabin.
John found us.
Yeah, that's when John found us. Yep.
And then I remember hearing the float plane taking off.
Yep.
And then it got really quiet. And we had no idea if they were ever coming back, when they were coming back to get us, who was coming back, how sick our buddy was.
We knew nothing.
It was just weird.
And I remember sitting there just listening to the quiet, because we had never heard quiet like
that. And this is at Snelgrove, for anybody listening. This is my first trip, maybe 150 trips I made there. And you've been there how many times?
Oh, 15 to 20 times easily.
Yeah, you've been to Snelgrove that many times?
Yeah.
And I just remember we didn't know when he was coming back and if ever. But it was, yeah, it turned out, it ended up as a great trip. I just kept filming, and the whole idea, we were up there filming a TV show. That's why we were there, and get back and find out our buddy's okay. And he had his gallbladder taken out and some little wee bit hospital and
yep.
some little town in Canada. And anyhow, to make a long story short, he called me up and he goes, yeah, it's too bad we can't do that TV show. And I said, what do you mean? I said, it's done. Because I had done his stand-up before he got sick. Because I sensed he wasn't looking good. So, anyhow, that was our first trip. We weren't thinking Bigfoot at that time.
No, that wasn't even part of the vocabulary.
I mean, that was nothing. And so, I don't know. We have so many stories we can tell, Joe. It's going to be a problem. We could be here till like 10 o'clock. But let's fast forward. And why don't you tell the story when we decided to take our daughters up there, which was obviously the first time, you know, we had Bigfoot activity.
Well, so again, we went to the same location, and we were with, it was a father-daughter trip. So we went up there, three guys and three young girls, and I think my daughter was the oldest.
Yeah. And
how old do you think she was? Maybe 10, 11, something like that. She was the oldest. The other ones are younger.
Yep.
And we ended up going to what this area that we called Secret Lake, because there's like a river that you have to take, but it's a real narrow river system that it's hidden, and it goes back to this whole other, you know, huge lake structure that we figured that nobody else was going back to. Doug just happened to find an inlet one of the trips that we did take. And so we were out there and we were fishing and of course catching nice fish and having a good time, and we were coming back, and I remember Doug saying, kill the engines, because where there was three boats and we were all kind of in a caravan coming back and just coming into this river system to connect us to the main lakes. And so we killed the motors and we're like, what? And he said, I thought I heard a wood knock. And I think that's one of the first times that I didn't even really realize.
Well, it wasn't a thought. It was, direct.
Yeah, I mean, you heard it. Yeah.
It was, well, you guys were way back there.
Yeah.
And so, you had your motors running.
Yeah.
And I had killed our motor because
Dakota was doing something.
She was fishing, and we were way ahead of you guys.
Yeah.
And she was fishing. She was making monkey sounds. It was right where the lake opens, right where the little stream opens up into the main lake.
And I do remember that,
Yeah, there was a huge wood knock right next to the boat. So, and that's kind of what started it. And then what do we waited till midnight, 1 a.m. We had Vladimir,
this
big Ukrainian guy that did a couple of wood knocks.
He said, I want to try something. Let's try a couple of wood knocks. So he kind of taught Vlad what to do, like the frequency and that kind of thing, that we'd sit and listen. And all of a sudden there was a knock. And I think it was closer to 3 a.m. when we heard this thing, but it was right around the end of the bay there. I mean, it was really close.
Yeah.
And I remember us just all talking about what it couldn't be. Like, it couldn't be a bear. It couldn't be a tree just falling over. And it was quite a moment.
Yeah. It was pretty quick. It happened with, I think the return knock happened within seconds.
We didn't have to wait very long at all. And no, then, if I remember right, there was pebbles and stuff being thrown at us too.
Yeah, right. We did a rock and we did a pebble exchange for quite a long time.
We were sitting by fire.
Tried to get this thing to do another wood knock. It never would.
Yep.
Tried to get it to scream or do anything. It wouldn't do anything. Just the pebbles. But remember, at the end there was that big splash.
Yep.
That was the finale.
Yep.
And then everybody went to bed, except me.
Except you. And then you had a whole other thing happen to you, didn't you?
Yep.
And you have to talk about that because I was obviously sleeping.
Yeah, which doesn't take much. So then, you and Vlad went to bed. The girls had already been sleeping.
Right.
But you and Vlad went to bed, and I just stayed up, and I was pretty wired because we had that rock exchange. And I just had never thought about Bigfoot's being at Snow. Such a vast wilderness. You just, you think, well, what are the chances,
Well, and going back to the very first time that I was ever up there, Doug, if you remember, you actually probably still have the video of it, but I had this really unusual feeling, like I was being, we were the ones being watched. I don't know if you remember that, but I felt I felt like I was in an environment that where animals were watching me, and I just had this really strange.
Yeah, you said that at Hidden Lake.
Yep.
You said, God, I feel like I'm being, you kept saying it. I feel like I'm being watched. I feel like I'm being watched. And it was weird too, because that's where the wood knock occurred.
And couldn't shake the feeling. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think you were right on your instincts. So then that night, I stayed up by a candlelight, just read an old Field and, you know, those old Field and Stream magazines that are up there.
Oh, yes.
That are nasty. Yeah,
many years old.
Yeah, God knows how many times they've all been to the outhouse. I didn't want to think about it. So I'm just reading that. Finally, I'm like, I'm starting to get tired. Go up to the window, and that's when all hell broke loose. And, you know, I heard, you know, screaming and stuff hitting the cabin, and the cabin heard something running on the roof, stuff hitting the roof and running. And, you know, that skylight that's there?
Yep, right above the kitchen there.
Yep, and I grab, I'm looking for the pole. I can't find the pole because I'm thinking, I'm picturing some infant dropping in from the skylight and getting stuck in there with a baby Bigfoot. Nice. I wanted to get that skylight closed. So I closed the skylight really quick. And that's the screaming just never ended. And it started when I went to the window and flipped that light on, that bright fluorescent light over the sink.
Yeah.
So I think they saw me and I just lit up.
So, you must have been, they must have been watching through the window or something. Yeah, yep. For sure.
That's the only thing I think. I mean, it turned on like that. Literally, the cabin was being rocked. It was being lifted from the corners. There was so much screaming going on. I ran into Vlad first, not you, Vlad. Started pounding on him. He never even moved. You at least flipped over once. But I was really pounding you guys.
That doesn't surprise me.
No, I think I could pound you even at any given night up there because of the fresh air. And
right.
You normally go to bed early, and I think we were up pretty late. And when you go down, Joe goes down, Alex. You haven't had the pleasure of the snoring, have you?
No, but it's legendary.
It's legendary, yeah.
There's a whole myth around it.
There's a few stories out there.
Anyhow, and then it quit. It just quit as quick as it started. And that's when I realized, you know, something was out there. And it was so cool. I mean, to me, it was pretty cool. But it was scary at the same time because I just thought these things would bust through the door or some shit. Pardon my French. But then when the floatplane pilot came and I told him about it, he was like, well, I don't doubt it. And I figured he would give me crap and he wouldn't believe me, but he did. And I'm like, why does he believe me? You know what I mean? And he goes, well, then he talks about the damage. You were going to say something, Joe?
I was just going to say, and so for people that don't know, this cabin is kind of on stilts, for lack of a better description, right?
Blocks.
It's on blocks with like poles. So it's the front of it is on the ground, but the back of it is all on stilts because of the terrain.
Right. Yep. But it's completely not connected to the ground.
No, not at all. It's just built on the surface.
Yep. Yeah, there's so many. The Canadian Shield area. But that kind of started, you know, the whole thing. And I'm trying to remember. So we went back then, and you were with, we went with Blaine.
Yep.
You were with the second time.
Yep.
Was that when Jeff?
Yeah, that's when that was the trip that Jeff and what was Kurt. The other scientist's name?
Yeah, Kurt Nelson. Yep. And you were on that trip.
I was on that trip.
Okay. And Blaine was on that trip, as I remember. Right.
And there was a lot going on in that trip. But I know that you said, "Oh, there's something going on up here. I want to check this out and bring a couple of guys, a couple of researchers up."
Yep.
And didn't you bait them in? That I remember. I mean,
God, we've been up there so many times. That's the problem. No, you're thinking of the Luddy trip.
Okay.
That's the only time I've ever done that. That was on that Luddy trip.
Where we put a bowl of food out with a string. Yep. Okay.
Yeah, with Luddy. So let's tell that story because, yeah, I put up a big bowl with eggs, cooked meat, raw meat, cooked bacon, raw bacon, apples, you know, or and all sorts of stuff, bananas. And then it was a stainless steel bowl with a big hole in it, and I tied fishing string, like 5-pound monofilament, and ran it in my bedroom window and piled up pans on a bed that was in there. It was empty. A bunk. Right?
Yeah, well, there was that. And I remember something about tying it to a pitcher because the pitcher moved.
Yeah.
If you remember, there was that.
No. No, yeah, you're all.
I'm blending stories here, so.
You're blending. Yeah, you're doing your Joey blend. But so, no, then I moved it the second night, put it out on the dock, and I felt safe.
That's what it was. Okay.
I put it on the dock, and then I built on the picnic table. I put the sound alarm on the picnic table.
That's what I was thinking of. That's the part I was thinking of.
Yep. And then you and Blaine were out there, and do you remember what happened when you fell and you got hurt?
Yeah, I heard something in the woods, and it freaked me out. And so I ran back into the cabin, which was kind of foolish, but I ran back into the cabin, and as I hit the wood patio, I slipped and fell.
Well, you left Blaine there.
And I was Blaine. You didn't even know what was going on. He just catches you running, and he's like...
He's like, what the heck? So he follows me in. And but the pitcher, everything had moved. The bowl had moved and the pitcher was moved. So something had tugged on that bowl.
After you guys came in, it tugged on it. That's when the trap went off.
Yeah, that's when the trap went off.
You guys were in the cabin. Everybody was in the cabin. We were telling us about the trees breaking or whatever.
Yep.
Because Blaine had to go out there and get you. Because you had fallen so hard.
Yep. Yeah, that's when he got me, exactly.
So I know it is hard because I've been there so many times.
I know, and I'm blending stories. I hate to do that too, but.
But so you guys
remember that. I mean, I vividly fell and Blaine vividly picked me up. And
yeah.
And
so
yeah, I did.
But you guys were in, the door was shut, and then the trap went off. So we deducted that the thing scared you guys in or tried to scare you in.
Yep.
Just to test the trap because the thing was moved a foot.
Oh, yeah, it was moved a foot. So we were trying to, again, figure out what would. But if I remember right, nothing was missing, right?
No, nothing. Weird.
Nothing was missing out of the bowl, so nope. We were trying to figure out if it was a wild animal, wouldn't it have eaten something, or it was a bear, I mean, the bowl would have been emptied, right? So
it would have been eating something, but no, something. I did everything in twos, so I knew if anything was missing.
So, yeah, very, very interesting. The whole situation was really interesting.
And then nothing touched the bowl for the rest of the trip.
Nope.
That I found really interesting.
Yeah. What is up with that?
Yeah. What contaminated the bowl? I mean, you know, this is in the wilds of Canada with cooked bacon, raw, there were raw eggs in there. There were hard-boiled eggs, cheese, apples, oranges. There were all sorts of things in there. Smelly things.
Looked good. Never got touched.
So anyhow, I think it was that night you had a few whiskeys.
Yep.
Blaine partook in shaving your mustache off.
Yep. I lost half my mustache that night. Actually, the whole thing, but it halves.
Yep. And as a prank, it's the kind of stuff we do when we go up there. Got to be careful. Yep. But then I was awoken by peeing outside my window that night. And I thought, oh, Joe's drunk, and he got up to pee, and it just kept peeing and peeing and peeing and peeing and peeing. And it was like really powerful. Now I'm like, I don't think that's Joe. And then all of a sudden the picnic table goes flying across the porch. And then you heard the next thing that happened, which was the rod case.
Oh yeah. Yep. And that's, I remember one of the guys that we were with stuck his head out the window, and wished that he heard all the chaos on the patio, and never well, he was afraid to stick his head up to the window to look out.
You're talking about that, Luddy.
Dave.
Oh, Dave.
Yeah.
Because we all woke up. I mean, it woke everybody gathered in the kitchen.
Exactly.
It was so amazing. I mean, when these things throw something at the cabin, it's not like clink. It's like, boom! And the whole cabin just shakes. And it was like that. So we believe it threw Dave's heavy rod case against the cabin with extreme force. So.
And if I remember right, wasn't there a hair sample or something?
It's in the show. Yep. There was a hair caught on the twist tie. That's the zip tie. There was a zip tie for a name tag. So, zip ties are interesting because who'd have thought it would have caught a hair?
Exactly.
But of course, the forensic lab debunked it, saying, well, it absorbed blue dye, so therefore it's human. Even though it had a tapered worn end, had no medulla.
Yep.
But the guy goes, well, it absorbed a hair dye, blue dye. So therefore it was a bleached hair. My God, any hair will absorb that blue dye.
You would think, right?
Oh, well, I know it will. It's bluing. Take one of your hairs and put it in bluing and tell me what it'll do. So he was like, well, it was bleached. And I was actually quite angry about that.
I remember that.
Yeah. And he couldn't get
it. All coming back to me. Yep.
Couldn't get any DNA out of it because their hairs don't have a medulla. There's no core. That's where most of the DNA is. So.
Right.
So that's what I read. But when was it? Was it the night before that you and Blaine stayed up? See, I didn't know anything about this, but you and Blaine had stayed up the entire night. He said you guys were perched, looking out the window the whole night. Tell me about that.
Well, that was, I just remember being so scared because of all the activity that was going on that I couldn't, because if I remember right, that was the last day. That was our last night there.
So the rod case slammed into the building, and then we had one more night to stay overnight.
Yep.
And that was the night you stayed up all night.
And that was the night I stayed up all night because it was just, you had this really uncomfortable feeling, and there was so much going on that I couldn't wait for that float plane to show up the next morning. And I remember sitting up all night I was so scared I got on the other side of scared, if that makes any sense. So it was quite a moment for me. One that I'll never forget and one that I'll always be thankful for, because I don't think most people get to experience anything that exciting.
You know? Did you believe in Bigfoot before the first time you had an encounter?
Well, I had always had an interest in Bigfoot, and not really aggressively, but just kind of passively. I remember as a child going to the movie theater to watch that Peter Graves film. What's that called? Mysterious Animals or Mysterious? I don't know if you remember the name of that. Mysterious Monsters. And I remember seeing the Patterson footage in that film. And I was always really intrigued by the mystery. And, you know, over time just kind of came and go, you know, came and went. But, you know, working and getting to experience a lot of the things that we have through Doug. And I mean, I've learned a lot over the years, and it's been a heck of a ride and a heck of an experience. And again, I guess, you know, if I had to kind of sum up, you know, my interest in believing, if I, you know, believe in Bigfoot or not, it's not a matter of believing. It's, you know, you see things and experience things that you don't have an explanation for. We talk about being in the gray bucket, you know, I'll just put that in the gray bucket. But you can always rule out what it's not or what you think is not anyways. And so, you know, kind of all roads point to, you know, Bigfoot, in my opinion. So,
well, let's go back. Do you remember? Okay. So it was shortly after the first trip, right? We went back again.
Yep.
We brought Josh up.
Yep.
For his graduation.
Yep, I remember that.
And do you remember the sound, the singing that we...
Yeah, I'll never forget that. I'll never forget that. And the reason why I won't is because there was a lot going on, kind of fun stuff, but there was, that was, I remember I saw my very first huge, what you'd consider a trophy pike, because on that particular, in that particular area where we were sitting, Josh had thought he caught the bottom of the lake, and he handed the pole back to his dad and said, "Here, Dad, I'm stuck on the bottom of the lake." And Doug handed the pole right back, said, no, you got a nice big fish on. And he pulled it and had a hard time getting it in. But how big was that pike? It was huge. I remember that.
Definitely. I don't remember.
But
I remember. But it was, yeah, close to 20 pounds.
So that was fun. And then we just sat there, and I remember just kind of enjoying that. And then all of a sudden we heard this really, and for lack of a better description, just this beautiful operatic sound. We're all like,
yeah.
Do you hear that? And again, we're in the middle of the woods. Where would that come from? We couldn't figure out, but it was operatic to describe it at least.
I mean, it sounded like a human, a female.
Yeah. Like a female singing opera, but it wasn't, you know, like a multi-tones, but it did fluctuate. The sounds did fluctuate. It was
loud.
Strange.
I mean we must have listened to that for, I remember, about 20 minutes or so.
It seems like probably right in that time. We weren't timing it, we were just taken back by it.
Nope. And this is before cell phones.
Yep.
And we wouldn't have had our cell phones with anyhow in those days. It would have been old little flip phones or whatever,
right?
Yeah.
I think it was after that they used to, that we started getting a satellite phone.
Okay, and also that was the same trip we saw that red light on that island go up and then back down. Do you remember?
Yes, that? I remember. I forgot about that, but I remember that. Yeah, we were. Yeah, there was this red light, and it would pop up over the trees and then come back down. That was strange. I mean, I don't have an explanation for that, but we saw it.
That was on the island, right across from the cabin.
Straight across. We were actually all at the cabin, and we were watching it go up and down.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was that?
Anyhow, that was Josh's first experience with the unknown, the singing, and then the red light. We did go outside and we watched it, but it was as bright as a car taillight.
Yeah, it was bright. It wasn't dim. It was putting on a show for us, it seemed. Yeah. I mean, it was crazy.
I'm not sure I've ever told that story.
Yeah, I mean, I completely forgot about it.
But that trip was life-changing for Josh, because he was a typical, you know, 16, 17-year-old kid. He just really didn't have any interest in helping out around the house and, you know what I mean, doing stuff like that. And we came back from that trip, and he was just a total different man. He was like, I remember right away, first night, he goes, "Can I set the table?"
No kidding.
Wow.
"Can I help with dinner? Can I clean up dinner?" You know what I mean? He was just like, and he never changed. It changed all of his values. He enrolled in that college and then got a job in the kitchen to pay for his tuition. Out east.
That's awesome.
Remember, he bought that Corvette. He saved up, bought that Corvette.
Yeah, I'll never forget.
Took off out east with his Corvette.
Yep.
And I didn't see him for, God, like 2 years.
That's crazy.
After Snelgrove, yeah.
Turned out to be a really good young man.
Changed his life.
Oh, it did. Yeah, it changed his life, Alex. Totally. Some people need that, you know. It's kind of like, maybe there's more to the world than we think.
Yeah.
Oh, geez. So I'm trying to think anything. Oh, and then I know we started going up with Morrison after Josh. And I don't think anything else ever happened. Ever.
Well, the only thing that comes to mind is the logs. There was those journals in the cabin.
Yep.
And there were people, not part of our group, but there were people that would leave notes about Bigfoot, or not Bigfoot sightings, but footprints in the portages. You remember that?
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
And so it's just, there's just a bunch. Again, you start looking at all the unusual things going on. And it definitely caught your attention and said, I've got to do something more with this.
And then years went by, and I'd gone up there you know, me and you had gone up there numerous times. We never did anything. Never did any wood knocking.
No, never did. No, it was never about, it was just about fishing. And
but we always went in June, yep. Around June 8th. And then Morrison stole my date.
I remember that.
And we had to start going in August. And that's when the berries are ripe.
Yep.
And that's when all hell broke loose. And that was the kind of a life changing thing. So thanks, Morrison, for stealing my dates.
Yeah.
See, that's what, you know, you bring people up there to share this place with them. And then they, you know, they want to go and they want to share with their buddies. And then they book your, all of a sudden they've stolen your week.
Well, of course.
That you've had for, my God, I had that week for 20 years.
Because you have a really tight window of time to get up there to, if you're going to catch good weather.
Yeah. So it was always June 8th. And I love the weather in that time. You know, fish were extremely hungry.
Great fish.
It was too early for any flies or, you know, mosquitoes or anything. Yeah. So, okay, let's. So you still haven't told me about this night you and Blaine sat up. Do you have any memories of that?
I remember being scared. That was the thing that I remember.
Okay.
I remember him calling out a couple times for you because he was nervous.
Yeah.
Well,
that was after the log got apparently the cord. That was a different trip. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was when Jeff was up there when the cordwood came slamming into the cabin. And that's when I would hear, you know, Blaine start freaking out.
Yeah, it was a very, again, special and surreal moment, but very, very exciting.
Now you actually had a really good Bigfoot sighting yourself, and we had one kind of, how would I put it? Do you remember we were by the campfire, we're burning trash, we heard chimp chatter. Remember, I always tell people it's the rock that we would bring the fish guts to.
Yep.
It was a routine day. And this was once again when the girls were up there, when we had all that activity, brought the walleye guts over to that rock, came back and we're burning trash. And we heard, me and you were standing by the fire, heard chimp chatter, and then we saw dark shadows walking back behind some of the smaller trees out that are in front of the rock.
I do remember something about that. I remember, it was kind of like when a bear came up. Remember when the bear came up into the cabin and the moment it got in the woods, it just simply just quickly disappeared. It was kind of that same thing. It was really hard to see, but yeah, there was definitely some figure movement back there. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah,
they
were upright. Yeah.
Yep,
well, there were actually two upright figures that walked, but we were listening. We were looking there because of the chatter. It sounded like two chimps fighting.
Right.
That's why we were looking over there.
And there's nothing back there. It's just a bunch of woods. So
there's nothing there.
Yeah.
It's not like chimpanzees fighting, you know. Thing is, when you're up there, there's so many, could be potentially any kind of animal, you know.
Right.
Potentially.
Well, I remember the talking about animals. I remember the caribou incident, what I called the moose incident.
Oh yeah. Yeah. So that was it. You came back. You were all excited. Like, I saw a moose.
Yeah.
And I said, "Did it have a white chest?" And you're like, "Yeah." And so. I said, I think you saw a caribou, which is a reindeer. You saw a reindeer.
Yeah, but it was a big one.
But you didn't know because you had never seen a moose. And
right.
You thought it was a moose. So I went over there, and it was by an island. I went over there, and I called the caribou. Are real easy to call. So I called the caribou in right up to our boat with, I think I was with you, Alex. You were on that trip.
I was on that trip?
Yep, you were in the boat when I called the caribou right up to the boat.
Oh yeah, because I remember when in the boat that I was in, it actually followed us back and forth in the shoreline, and it freaked me out. That's when I
It was trying to kill us. Yeah. You don't remember that, Alex? You were freaked out.
It was freaky.
Because you were like, we better, Dad, you gotta move the boat back from the shore. It's gonna get in the
That
boat.
Sounds like me.
We're all cautious.
Yeah.
And I still cannot believe you don't remember that moon that came up that freaked me up. I was actually scared because the moon covered as far as I could see to the right and as far as I could see to the left. It came up like another planet.
I've never seen that before either. That was very, very bizarre. I remember that.
Yeah, so Joe was there.
It covered the whole sky.
The whole sky, the moon. From like as far as you could turn your head to the right, as far to the left. And I literally thought something's wrong.
Yeah, there's it was the strangest thing I've ever seen, for sure.
You know? And you don't remember. No,
I must have blocked it out.
Yeah, because you weren't that young. I mean, you were, what, 9, bro?
Do you remember how I reacted? Was I afraid?
Yeah, you guys were both crying. You and Blaine were both crying because you were that freaked out. And I was like, it's fine. I just, you know.
Did we say anything?
I don't know. I mean, it's a blur, too.
It is a blur. I mean, some of the high points to come. What
did you
think remember, like... Alex? There were years I would go up there 20 times.
Yeah.
And I just, every trip is just a blur. And I dragged you kids up there plenty.
So what did you think? I mean, did you think the world was
ending? I had no idea. Never seen anything like it. I know how the moon can be magnified, obviously, from the atmosphere. I mean, that's, but not bigger than the Earth.
No.
You know, it was like Uranus was about to hit the Earth. As high as you could look up, as far right as you could look, and as far left.
Wow.
No doubt.
It was that big. And it was like unlike anything I've ever seen in a movie or anything. It was just conditions must have been just right with the air temperature and the God knows what. I have no idea. That was really bizarre. You know, I mean, when I get scared, it's bizarre.
Yeah, you don't scare easy.
I don't scare that easy.
When I'm not scared, it's bizarre.
So anyhow, what we were going to talk about? We were going to, your Bigfoot sighting. So tell that whole story that happened here in Minnesota.
That's a
crazy story.
Yeah, so... because it's kind of a long story. So basically what happened was I was going to go meet a contractor that Doug and I work with. And prior to that, Doug had asked if I had ever driven around this certain area. And I said, no, I mean, it's funny because I've lived in this area my whole life and I've never driven in or looked in that area.
Well, yeah, but you got to preface it. We bought some land.
Okay, yeah. And we did. I didn't know how much you wanted to get into that. But yeah, the company had bought some land. And so we were meeting with a contractor to go over a few things. And he was running about 20 minutes late. And it was like 2:30 in the afternoon. So I thought, I got about 20 minutes to kill here. So I'll go for a quick drive. I was right there basically in the neighborhood. And so this road is in a kind of a rural neighborhood, but it's still pretty much the city. And so I'm driving down the road and the road comes to a kind of a sharp right curve and then it goes up a hill. And as I'm coming up over the hill, all I can tell you is that I see this auburn colored upright walking creature take two steps into the woods. I mean, it was basically across the road. But it had its back or side to me, so it didn't even know that I was there. I caught it off guard.
So was it on the right side or the left side of the road?
It was at the end of the road before the road jogged straight left.
No, I know, but did it cross from left to right?
It crossed from left to right, yes.
So it did cross in front of your truck?
Yes, yep. And I just was kind of, you know, processing the information, and I went back to Doug a little while later, and he's like, he explained to me what I thought I saw.
No, that's not you. You called me and you go, did deer walk upright?
Well, that's what I asked you when I went to you and said, yeah, do deer walk upright? And you're like, oh no. And so I asked him what I saw, and I pointed to a shoe. He had a rack, shoe rack hanging in his office, and I pointed to a pair of shoes. And I said, "Yeah, I saw an auburn color, the color of the inside of your shoe here, creature." And it walked right in front of the truck, but it was moving fast, and I caught it just coming over this hill. And so we obviously, you know, concluded that it had to be some. It was a Bigfoot. And there's no doubt about it. It wasn't a bear. It wasn't a deer. It wasn't any other known creature.
Well, you know what it wasn't.
Yeah. So we know what it wasn't. So, I mean, that's the conclusion that I came up with. Anyways.
But how many guys get to see a Bigfoot in broad daylight?
And that's the thing. It completely caught me off guard. And I was not looking for a Bigfoot. I was driving the neighborhood just to check it out before meeting a contractor. So anyways, so then Doug said, a good friend of his is a tracker. And so he said, well, let's bring him out there and see what he says, this animal, what direction it would go if it was, you know, where it would cross the road if it was in this area. So, but he didn't know that it was a Bigfoot at that point. And so he just knew it was a wild animal. So we're driving through the neighborhood, and he found the exact pinch point that I had my sighting, the exact point. And so then Doug, it's like he explained to him what was going on. And so didn't we start door knocking at that point?
There was some of that. Why don't you explain these lakes, this old chain of lakes that nobody really can go on?
So, yeah, so it's a really interesting area. So this chain of lakes we learned was owned by a group of people that they own it, and I think it's the last known property in Minnesota that they not just own to the shore, but they own under the lake. And
they have riparian rights. They call it riparian.
Is that what that is? Okay. Yeah. So they own the whole property, every piece of it. And it's, they have signs all around the perimeter of this area that don't allow anybody in.
No trespassing.
So it's no trespassing signs. So it's very, very protected. And, I remember, didn't you meet with somebody at one point that said that they allowed a couple people in there to do some studies for the university or something?
Yep. They were botanists. Yep. They allowed them in by canoe, but they weren't allowed to go on land, which really struck me as weird.
Yep.
I mean, and they apparently found plants that were thought to be extinct.
Yeah, it's fascinating because, not only if they thought that they're going to be extinct, is that like prime habitat for some unknown animal to reside, live? It was crazy.
What's the name of the road? I thought that was a funny coincidence, too.
What is the name of the road? I'm drawing a blank. I know it's something really, it's catchy, too.
Furman Road.
Furman Road. There you go. Furman Road. It's on the map. It is. It's called Furman Road. So a bunch of people own hunting property that they don't allow hunting on, and no trespassing. And the road next to it is called Furman Road.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. Kind of strange. So then about a week later, all of a sudden, there was a person that had recorded a Bigfoot that made the news.
It was a couple.
Yeah, with a man and a woman, and it made Fox News, that I remember. Was that, I can't remember the channel now, but either way, he had recorded it, and there's some recording. I'm not sure how good the video is, but so it was really interesting because that story made the news, and when Doug did the research, that was within a couple of miles of my sighting. And so I remember trying to reach out to trying to find that couple that actually shot the video. And didn't you do a reward or something? You were offered some reward?
I offered. I ran an ad. I did a display ad. Offered a reward for months and months. 3 months I offered a reward. It was a pretty big reward, too.
Just to connect the dots so that we could talk to those people and say, hey, what did you see? And because they didn't know what I saw. And what made it, kind of really...
It was the color.
That's just that they
auburn. They described it as auburn too. Auburn.
And they didn't know about my sighting, but I didn't know about theirs because theirs made the news naturally. And Doug was the only guy that knew that I had had my sighting before that sighting. So it again, really, really cool. And
the footage may not even be online anymore, which is weird too.
Oh.
It used to be called the Stillwater footage or the St. Croix Bigfoot footage. And then that disappeared. And I don't even know if it's
I didn't know that. Interesting.
It's featured in the show, History Channel show with Scott Wolter, America Unearthed.
America Unearthed, yep.
They do show a clip because they couldn't license the footage because we couldn't license it because we don't know who shot it.
Couldn't get a hold
of it. So the History Channel crew had to film the screen that you had in your hand.
Yep.
So it's so if you look up America Unearthed Bigfoot, then you can see Joe featured in that, and I'm in it too, I guess. So.
So again, I mean, you're in these situations, and you know, I guess kind of getting back to a little philosophy, that's one of the things that Doug always, I mean, early on, I mean, again, I've known him most all my adult life. I mean, literally since I've been 17, 18 years old. And I'm old now, but one of the things early on is he taught me always don't have tunnel vision. Don't look up, look around, be aware of your surroundings. And we also talked about kind of this collective consciousness. The more you're aware of something, the more you'll kind of see. And
yeah.
So I've always just kept an open mind. And
well, I really do think, you know, as I get older, I do think more and more our thoughts affect what happens to us.
Yep.
So you were at that point had already been comfortable with the existence of Bigfoot. The universe allows you to see one.
I remember you slugged me. You said people spend their whole lives looking for one of these, and you just happen to trip over one.
Yeah, in broad daylight yet. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean, that close, too. I mean, you weren't far away.
No.
But when I went there, and when I looked at where the thing was, because you have to go around a corner, then down a hill, and then there's another corner you got to go around. So that thing had no idea. I guarantee you were just coasting.
Oh, yeah. I had no idea it was there.
No,
you just busted. It's funny. Just like a bear, it just disappeared into the woods just that quick. The tree line.
Well, it was actually that, your encounter that really pushed me towards e-bikes, thinking, you know, these things aren't all that aware if you're silent. You know, because I imagine most people are in a hurry to get home. They're gunning their cars down those dirt roads. They hear them coming, and they book away.
Yep.
You, because you didn't live there, and you're not weren't trying to get home. You were trying to kill time.
Yeah, I was. I was literally moving.
So you were going slow on
probably
purpose.
20 miles an hour. I was just going slow through the neighborhood. Yep.
And that's why you busted it, because it didn't hear you.
It makes sense.
So that's why, that's where it really gives me the you know, the encouragement to develop, do research by e-bike, you know.
It was
your
really
sighting.
Super, super cool idea.
Yeah.
So.
So I just, you know, I remember when Time Life interviewed me about how I thought the Bigfoot mystery would get wrapped up, and I just said, Tesla. That's how the mystery will be solved, Tesla.
Good answer.
Yeah, it'll be an electric car. It just comes, you know, silently barreling around a corner. Around
autopilot.
On autopilot,
right into it.
Yep.
And it'll be a collision, and the thing will go flying in the air 30 feet and die. So there you go. Or one of these new electric semis.
Oh, man, yeah.
That they're going to be releasing soon.
I've heard about that, Between here in Milwaukee, I heard.
So, okay, so we got that out of the way. But, yeah, what really got me is this couple that filmed it. And I'm like, because when you said Auburn, I had never taken an Auburn report in Minnesota, ever.
Never.
No one had ever come to me, or I'd never heard of one, not personally, you know, and it isn't like I read every encounter in Minnesota, but I had no experience with that. So then when the other one was Auburn, I was like, oh, my God, they saw your creature, because it was exactly due east of your sighting.
Yep.
Like, exact. And I was like, oh, man, it would have been so cool.
Get a hold of them.
Oh, maybe they still will. Maybe they'll hear this. you know, they need to come forward so we can, you know, talk to them.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. There's probably more that can be learned.
Oh God. Yes.
Between the two sightings.
Yeah. And their footage is actually really good. It's not bad at all. I mean, it ducks really low and just cruises through a bunch of low trees. I guess it's at the edge of a windbreak on their farm.
Okay.
And near Big Marine Lake is the location. It's where I'm guessing the location is.
Okay.
So which sighting was first?
Joe's.
Joe's sighting was first?
Yep. And didn't we catch it on the news live by accident?
We did. We were I think we were sitting in your garage.
Yeah, remember. We were over. You were over here, and we saw it live.
Totally taken back. I was like, oh, somebody had a
sighting. What are the chances of that?
No kidding.
The coincidences.
Yeah, it was quite a moment. I remember that.
Yeah, I don't believe in coincidences anymore. There's no way. No way. This can't be. So I'm definitely a believer. I mean, there's other. Me and Joe have had so many stories, and we got plenty of time. We have a lot of weird things that happen occasionally, and then it'll go away for a long time. Nothing will happen. Then occasionally something weird will happen, and I think one of the first ones was when I was going to get put out to have a tooth pulled or something, like one of my wisdom teeth. And you came and picked me up really early in the morning because we had to drive to St. Paul to see my dentist in St. Paul. And so you picked me up. It was like 5:30 in the morning.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Okay. So you go ahead and you can finish the story.
Well, yeah. So I'm sitting in his driveway. And of course it is. It's very early in the morning. And I happen to just look to the west. I guess I was confused over there. To the left from your driveway.
Yeah.
I think that's straight west. And
it's
saw a row of lights. And there was, seven or eight lights. I guess I can't remember now because it's so long we talked about it. But there was that's what caught my caught me completely off guard, because there was above the tree line and there was a row of lights. And then I remember calling Doug and telling him what I'm seeing, and I think I don't know if you got a shot out the window or stick your head out the door, and all of a sudden they kind of all blinked off at one time, and that's what I remember of it.
Well, you told me what I remember you telling me is they went off one at a time.
Okay, so
each light went off one.
And I remember they all went off. So yeah, I guess they did go off one at a time. You remember the story better than me, because it's all faded. It's been years. That had to be 20 years ago.
Yeah, it's quite a long time ago.
But I remember they all went out, though, and I couldn't. It wasn't like it was an airplane. I mean, like it was because it was so wide. The lights in the sky were so wide.
Yeah,
I couldn't figure out what it was. So
yeah, and I never saw them. I had to go, but I do remember just once again that one. Streaky side of me, I call a vet and I go, yeah, Joe said there was a UFO over the house. Okay, goodbye. I'm going to the dentist. Streaky side. That was a long time ago. So then, and you've had actually enough. So you were driving back with your parents.
Yep.
From Hinckley.
Yep.
And then you had something really weird. You saw something there. Why don't you tell that story?
Yeah, so I can tell you, and I remember this one because we were coming back, and we were south on the highway coming home. And again, over the tree line, there was this bright green light. And it wasn't like a street lamp. It was high over the trees. And again, I have no idea what it was. My wife saw it, and I even believe my folks saw it. Don't have an explanation for it, but it was interesting because it just sat there and just hovered way over the trees. And, you know, as we drove by, I couldn't see it anymore. But
was this like chartreuse?
Yeah, it was more of like a day glow or chartreuse green color. So it was a real bright green. Again, fascinating. I couldn't tell you what it was, but it was really fascinating. So it's one of those things that I put in my gray bucket. So
yeah, no.
And we talked about that. You talked about orbs and those types of things.
I've seen so many of these colored orbs, blue ones, green. I've seen the bright green ones, sparking ones. And I think you saw a sparking fireball one time after.
I have no. If I did, I don't have a memory of it.
You don't have no memory of that.
Nope, it's gone. Ka-chink. Sorry. Sorry to disappoint.
Well, you. It may not have been you. Somebody may have told me that.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. What else have you seen? Oh, the night that my daughter Asia was born was a weird. The morning was weird.
The morning was weird. I remember that.
Okay, so let me. So I'll set it up, and then you can tell the story. It's a great story.
Okay.
So, my youngest daughter Asia was born. Dakota was being babysit by you and Cheryl. I went to pick Dakota up that night.
Yep.
Came home uneventful. She left her favorite doll at your house.
Yep.
And I assured her that you would bring it by in the morning before we went back to the hospital to see little Asia. And you came over. And do you remember the story?
So I don't remember if it was you that said something first or I said something, but I remember we both said, "What the heck happened to you?" Because then I had a big scratch down my face.
Oh, it's huge.
I said, "I don't know. That just happened last night." And I said, "That's really strange. It's my watch is broke, too. Yeah. My crystal, and it got completely smashed." And so then you went and looked, and you had like a big suck mark or something. It's like a big
ring. A whole bunch of them on my face.
Yeah, on your face. And you got like that hickeys. That same night.
Yeah, they were like hickeys.
So we're both looking at each other like, "What the heck happened to you?"
Well, no. What exactly happened is I said, "What did you do to your forehead?" He goes, "What do you mean, me?" He goes, "What happened to you?"
Yeah.
And the bathroom was like 2 feet away, so I went and looked in the mirror, and I'm like, "What the frick?" And then you go, "Oh, we must have been to our special place last night. It's like we were abducted by aliens or some crap." It was weird. I don't know. It was just weird that that all happened the night my daughter was born.
Well, then we had a series of events that happened kind of after that I remember.
Yeah, there was quite a few of them, but probably the most memorable and the funniest one is the ice one.
The ice one is probably the best one, yeah.
So you can judge this one. So I was at Jimmy John's, and I was just trying to get a Coke, and their ice machine works really good there, and you just tap it and it fills your cup up instantly, like to the brim with ice. Like, how brilliant is that? So when you get your Coke, they're hardly giving you any Coke, right? It's all ice. So I kept filling it. I just wanted a few ice cubes. So finally, I just kept dumping them. Well, one time I dumped it too quick, and they flew across the room. There was nobody in there, but they actually flew across the room. My phone rings, and it's you, and you say...
I said, "Doug, I have to tell you... this is a Saturday afternoon, and I had two employees working in our assembly department, and one guy accused the other guy of throwing ice at him. And he thought he reached into his lunchbox and was throwing ice at him. And the guy said, "I don't have any ice in my lunchbox. Look, I've got one of those ice packs. There's no ice chunks in there." And so I look on the ground, and there's water spots, melted water spots. I'm like, "What is going on?" And so then I called Doug and let him know. And he said, "Well, I just got done throwing my cup at Jimmy John's. What the heck?" It was
Your exact words were, "Did you just throw ice?"
And yeah. I said, I mean, I that's exactly what I said. I said, "Did you just get done throwing ice? Because where did this ice come from?" And I was just joking. I didn't mean it. Yeah. And then, of course, Doug told me that he was at Jimmy John's. He just emptied his glass because it overfilled. So,
I don't know. You don't know what to make of those things. It just goes in your gray bucket.
It's just gray bucket. Yep.
Yeah. It's interesting.
But they're true stories. I mean, absolutely happened.
Coincidence? Could be.
Yeah.
Could be. Or it might not be. What are the chances of me throwing ice, Alex, and having this guy get hit with ice?
Yeah. Well, so what do you think happened? Do you think it like went through a portal or something? Like,
well, no, I mean, they say that, you know, that we're
connected.
No, they say there's unlimited dimensions. So there's unlimited Alex's right now, unlimited Joey's, and we're all doing a little different thing. And so maybe, you know, it's...
It affected a different dimension.
Yeah, right. It had one effect, you know, could have been because Uranus was next to Saturn. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, you can guess all day. We're not going to know.
Exactly.
So it could have, may have not have, you know, even happened. Just in our minds it happened. I don't know, but he claims there was proof. The guy had wet water on his shirt and,
yep,
you know, that he did get it.
Yeah, I mean, at the very least, it's an incredible coincidence. It's super, super interesting.
Yeah, it's a fun, what do you call a fun coincidence? It does humble you a little bit.
Well, it makes you think.
Like, and we had other things happen like that we won't even get into, but there's been other things where I've done something and, you know, then it'll go away. It won't happen anymore. So
didn't Joe have like an encounter with like a gargoyle or some other creature?
Oh yeah, there was something that ran in front of your car, you and Cheryl's car one night.
Yeah.
This white thing.
Yeah, I don't know what that was. I can just tell you that we were driving to southern Minnesota. We were just north of Medelia. And again, it's one of those strange things. I mean, all of a sudden out of the middle of nowhere, this white, clear, kind of cloudy looking thing, for lack of a better description, just over the roof of the car, the hood of the car, went from right, so the passenger side to the driver's side to the middle of the road. And it I should have hit it. Whatever it was, I should have hit. And I don't know what it was. I mean, it's in the middle of farm country, and I don't know what to tell you. The highly likelihood that it was a great big large plastic bag flying through, there's not a chance. I mean, it would have had movement. And all I can tell you is that this thing moved fast from left to right and was white and kind of cloudy looking, and probably stuck up about a foot over the hood of the car as I was moving.
And you should have hit it.
I should have hit it. I mean, it was that close to the car. I should have hit it. I don't have any other way to explain that.
Well, you know, that happened to me too when I was with Adam, and I was on the phone with Louie Anderson, the comedian. And we were up north and driving, and I saw this white blur thing that looked to me like a big puzzle piece, like from a crossword puzzle.
Okay.
Because the sun hadn't set yet. And it zipped right in front of my car, and I should have hit it. But it was also white.
Yeah, so, I mean...
I don't... It's just completely gray.
Gray bucket, yep.
So, you know, and Adam didn't see it. He was buried in his phone.
Yeah. Well, I was distracted. My wife with me on that one, too. And we both talked about it. I was like, what the heck was that? And we couldn't figure it out.
But I just know Louie Anderson was on speakerphone. Adam was buried in his phone, looking down and texting somebody. And then this thing just shoots right in front of my car. White.
Yep. Wow. How do you explain that?
White.
Yeah, so it would, but Joe's could have been something totally different. But the fact we both experienced something like that is once again a kind of a coincidence. Yeah. And I made a big deal out of it. I was so surprised, and Adam did not see it. You know, and of course he picked that one time to look down.
Yeah, just
because Adam goes, "Oh, I love hanging out with Doug because I always see weird crap when I'm with Doug." And it was weird because the last. We went camping in like the end of October. And sure enough, he wakes me up at like 3-4 in the morning in his underwear. He wakes me up and I had just fallen asleep. Oh my God. And he's like, come outside. Something weird going on out here. So I go outside and there's what looks like UFOs that fill the whole sky. All over in the horizon, in the trees. They were everywhere. There were these balls of light. Thousands, hundreds, I don't know. It's one of the weirdest things I've ever seen. And all of a sudden, I see Adam walking off into the forest in his underwear. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing?
You're about to be abducted.
Oh, my God. He's walking towards the lights in his undies.
Oh, jeez.
And I'm like, that's not a good thing to do, Adam. Right? Missing 411. Don't do that.
Was he, like, not fully there?
I don't think he was. He was, like, half asleep. Yeah. But to this day, I don't know what we saw. It was, like, non-physical lights. They were quite bright, and they were everywhere. And they were dancing all over the sky, not northern lights. They were balls of light. But the balls were all different sizes.
Do you think if you hadn't stopped him, he might not have come back?
I don't know what would have happened. I have no idea. Who knows? But there's that weird thing, see?
And just going back to all the experiences, didn't we have some experience? I mean, I shouldn't say didn't we. I know we had some experience up in the cabin in northern Minnesota.
Oh, yeah. We haven't even talked about that.
Yeah.
That was really freaky. Okay, so I'll try to preface this quick as I can. What time is it? Because of Snelgrove, we were looking for something on the American side that would be remote, that we could rent, that would be, you know, off the grid, like Snelgrove is, solar powered, all that crap. And so we found a place close to the Boundary Waters canoe area. We went in August during Barry, the same time. We get there after, I think it was like 11 miles on a logging road, right?
Yep. Yep.
And we get there, and there were bugs. Oh, my God. I don't think I've ever seen that many bugs in my life.
They were thick.
It was bad, bad, bad. But we get there, and we go to unload, and I think Blaine did one wood knock, bless his heart. And right away, there was this kind of a barky, I can kind of do it. It was like, out of the woods, like right next to the cabin.
Yep.
And AJ goes, okay, I'm going to the cabin.
That was yep, that'd be me.
And I don't know, did you hear that? Were you in the cabin or were you outside? Do you remember hearing that?
I remember it. I didn't hear it, but I remember you guys talking about it.
Okay.
I was inside.
So when she goes in, we go in and she makes me tape blankets up in all the windows. She goes, Dad, this is going to be our room. I'm sleeping in your room, blah, 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 blah. After that,
Because you very guys stayed metallic-y. On the upstairs part.
It was like a bark growl. Yeah. Anyhow, that happened really quick. That's like having action really quick. So I tape up the windows with blankets with duct tape. That night, I hear something walking on the porch and opening the, remember it had a glass recycle bin? And the other side of the door was an aluminum one.
Yep.
And it opened and closed the glass, went over and over and over and over. And I thought, what in the world? And I'm thinking, oh, crap, is that a Bigfoot on the porch? And then I hear it open and close the other one, the recycling bin, almost like autism. Did it like 20 times each one.
Yep.
Then it went down and played with your truck, your tonneau cover. And I'm looking at my 30-30 on the floor, unloaded. And I'm looking at my daughter going, okay. You know, you don't want to rock the boat. So I'm just listening. And listen to this thing do that same, repeated it over and over and over. And then all of a sudden, the grand finale, boom, into the side of the cabin. The bed flew away from the wall. AJ, was the first time I ever heard her swear. She goes, what the F, you know?
Wow.
Because she heard it and we both heard it.
Yeah.
It was quite low. It was like a semi truck crashed into the wall. Well, then apparently it got you one night on your wall because you were down in the basement.
Yep.
Is this when he was in the basement? You guys made him sleep in the basement?
We made Joey sleep in the basement.
Yeah.
Well, it's not really a basement, it's like a lower level.
You were on the higher level.
It was a walkout lot, right? It was a walkout lot.
Yeah, it was a walkout.
Yeah. Okay, but there was a two story or whatever.
Right.
Made me second guess if I wanted to stay down there or not because of the walkout.
Yeah, he's ground level. Well, I was ground level too, but I was up by the porch.
Right.
So Joe was prime rib, and you guys.
Yeah.
Tucked away upstairs.
Yeah, I was dry rubbed ribs up on the, yeah, St. Louis style up on the first floor.
Anyhow, and was Joe by himself on the main level?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Oh, of course. No backup.
And your brother was up on the in the loft. He felt safe up there.
Yep.
Yeah.
So every night we had put recorders out. Every night it was attacking a new wall. So apparently the last night that got you on your wall, correct, Joe?
Was yep. That?
I don't even remember the story, but.
Yeah, I mean that's just that I remember sitting up all night long after that going, oh my God. You know, it was again, it was just what was going on out there, what was making the sounds, why would it pick my wall?
Yeah. And
I don't know. I had a philosophy that maybe my snoring was drawing it in. Like,
well, what happened down there?
I just woke up to a boom. I mean that's
oh, it's honestly, a boom.
Yeah.
Okay.
Next to the side of the house.
Yeah, I was trying to sleep, Joe. You're waking it up. It was.
Gosh. So that was actually plenty of activity. I mean, we were kind of on edge there, too. I was, because once again, you have your daughter. It was Asia's first trip.
Yep.
And she's scared enough now. She doesn't want to do it anymore. So then Blaine comes to the conclusion, well, geez, it must be paranormal because wherever we go, we seem to have action. But we were in the right area, near water, near a bunch of, you know, blueberries, in the right time of year, you know, in a wilderness area, and we were wood knocking, and you know, so I don't know.
Did I ever tell you that we saw a moose standing in a pond?
Yeah, I know. I know exactly where. Yep. Yeah. I saw it too. Eventually.
It was very, very cool. And it wasn't that far away, probably 50 feet away.
Yeah.
On the other side of a small pond.
That was the cabin. That was a real moose. Yeah, real moose. Yeah. Yep. Anyhow, so what time we got? 9:02. So let me look here. I'm just looking at my notes. I made a few notes in case I didn't forget. I think we kind of covered everything.
Yes, and certainly all the high points. I mean,
we covered the high points.
Many stories that aren't related to that we could just go on and on.
I'm going to drive people crazy, but anyhow, it's fun. It's fun to reminisce, and certainly fun for people to hear your Snelgrove stories. Yeah, absolutely. And we're going back up in August.
Yep, for sure.
So, and you actually had a little trepidation going there.
I did. I mean, if somebody was just asked me if I was ready to go back, I don't know. I mean, I definitely would, but I was initially nervous at answering that question. Yes. Just because, I mean, I know of all the activity up there, and yeah, it can be testing.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I'd be lying if I didn't get a little concerned, because you never know, you know.
Well, when does excitement turn into fear?
Well, I mean,
as soon as you hear anything,
well, I hope we hear something, and then you're like, oh no, I heard something.
Hey, Alex, let's do something right now while we got you. While everybody's here, let's get everybody's opinion. Let's turn your gain down on your mic.
Okay.
Live, we'll do it live. That's cool. Turn it down, and it's good when you're talking, but when you're giving us your lovely laugh, we love your laugh.
All right.
Go ahead and talk.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, that's good. I think that's good.
That's good.
You have a very clear, beautiful voice.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah. Mine's worn out and old.
So when excitement goes to fear, Alex, is when your whole party is standing around a campfire and all of a sudden a rock gets thrown up on the roof. And you hear it rattle down.
That's when you abandon your compadres and sprint for the door. Every man for himself.
No, it's just every man. It's always every man for themselves.
No matter what.
It still is, yeah. How much did you turn your gain down on your mic?
A click.
Do one more click.
All right.
I got to get you to laugh again. Can't fake it. You gotta really do it.
Yeah, you gotta really do it.
But yeah, because I know Blaine had his junk hanging out, and he got a rock at Snelgrove, slammed into him, and that actually made
him,
That made Kurt.
We'll make it clear he was peeing. He wasn't just whipping.
Well, no, he was peeing. But that's a vulnerable feeling when you're peeing.
Oh, yeah.
That happened to me one time when I was at the Pinchaw Gifford National Forest near Mount St. Helens. And we had so much of mixed company, and I walked down a embankment to go down into this little hollow to pee, to walk far away because they had gotten lights going on the boundary, the spotlights.
Sure.
And so I walked down this embankment just to get far enough away where I felt, you know, comfortable. And of course, I'm peeing and I get this growl right next to me. And of course, you're peeing. You don't know whether to just, you know, you don't know what to do. That's the trip that our driver quit because he got growled at.
Yep, I remember that.
And he grabbed the rental car. He just took off. He's, I'm out of here.
He said, yep, that's enough of that.
Enough of that. I'm not staying here anymore.
Well, when you guys go, I still want you to consider the idea of strapping a GoPro to someone's head and sending them outside the cabin.
Yeah, with a line just to the GoPro.
Just to the GoPro.
Just a string, just to the GoPro.
Wouldn't that be great?
Oh, so what was peeing outside the window? Obviously, I could have looked, and I didn't. I regret that.
Yeah,
I regret it, but I don't. Because it violently threw that picnic table across the porch.
Yep.
Then violently threw the rod case. So what if I would have opened the curtain and said, hey, Bigfoot?
Yep.
Hey, boy. You know, what would it have done? I don't know.
What would it have done? We'll never know.
You hate to have bloody arm sockets. Empty bloody arm sockets is not my cup of tea, because that's what your mind envisions, and that's exactly why you don't open the curtain.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it could be right there.
Yeah, you don't know.
Yeah,
it takes you want to. You know, people can say, "Oh, yeah, well, I would do it." Yeah, okay.
Right.
Maybe you would. Maybe you would.
Why didn't you get a picture? Well,
exactly. I did. You know, I did burst out the door standing upright. And had that high def camera and ran out the front door.
Right.
As quick as I could, you know, get my shoes on or whatever I had to do, which was only maybe 40 seconds. And I got out the door. I'm not afraid that way. But to open a curtain when something might be right there is kind of a different deal.
Yep, for sure.
At least if you're on your feet, you can get away, you know, versus a hand coming in, you know, the old... what's that old documentary that takes place down in, I can't think of it. The one where the window, the hand comes through the window.
Yeah, I can picture that.
Yep. Smoky Crabtree creature. I can't think of it. Can anybody think of that?
I can't.
Boggy Creek. About. The Legend of Boggy
Creek. Oh, the Legend of Boggy Creek.
Yep.
Yeah. There's a scene where the babysitter has a hand come right in through the window and
grabber.
Yeah, that sticks with you.
No good. Yeah.
That's what prevents you from opening the window.
Yeah.
That's snow.
Yeah.
So, and do I want to see one that under those terms? No, I want to see it like you did, Joe.
Right.
Doors locked out your window.
In a car with
in a car.
Yep.
No, not a car, a Dodge Ram. Big Dodge Ram.
A big Dodge Ram. Meant for ramming.
So anyhow, so I was going to end tonight by some wisdom of the benefits of using really good vocabulary, right? Knowing those big words. So I recently called a guy, right, an engineer, and a buddy of mine, and I asked him. I said, "Well, what are you?" I haven't talked to him in a long time. I said, "What are you working on these days?" So he goes, "Well, I'm working on an aqua thermal treatment of ceramics and aluminum." Plus steel under a constrained environment. And I said, what are you talking about?
Great.
He goes, I'm washing dishes and my wife is watching me.
That's awesome.
So use your big words. I mean, it sounds so sophisticated. Anyhow, so with that, let's sign off. Thanks so much, Joe.
Oh, you bet. Thanks for having me, guys. It was a lot of fun.
Thanks, Alex. I hope you feel better. I hope Blaine feels better.
Yeah.
Hope nobody gets sick. Wash your hands and keep your powder dry. We'll see you.
See you guys.
All right. See you guys. Bye.
Call you up in the middle of the night. Been bothered by dreams, ain't feeling all right. You give me comfort, say just give it some time. By the end of our talk, I'm feeling just fine. You and I will always know where we belong. This ain't no ordinary love we got going on. I pick you up in my 59 Ford. We head on down the road until we get bored. Just you and me and the sun and the wind. If the rain should stop falling, we'll head on home again. Everybody else can see where we belong. Should be in doubt, and I pray they never can prove.